Penguin Random House Audio presents The Outlaw Ocean, Journeys Across the Last Untamed Frontier by Ian Urbina. Read for you by Jason Culp, with an introduction read by the author.
To Aiden. For all its mayhem and exhaustion, there's been no greater adventure and no prouder project than being a part of your pit crew. Introduction. About 100 miles off the coast of Thailand, 36 Cambodian boys and men worked barefoot all day and into the night on the deck of a purseiner fishing ship. 15-foot swells climbed the sides of the ship, clipping the crew below the knees. Ocean spray and fish innards made the floor skating rink slippery. Seesawing erratically from the rough seas and gale winds, the deck was an obstacle course of jagged tackle, spinning winches, and tall stacks of 500-pound nets. Rain or shine, shifts ran 18 to 20 hours. At night, the crew cast their nets when the small silver fish they target, mostly jack mackerel and herring, were more reflective and easier to spot in darker waters. During the day, when the sun was high, temperatures topped 100 degrees Fahrenheit, but they worked nonstop. Drinking water was tightly rationed. Most countertops were crawling with roaches. The toilet was a removable wooden floorboard on deck. At night, vermin cleaned the boys' unwashed plates. The ship's mangy dog barely lifted her head when the rats, which roamed on board like carefree city squirrels, ate from her bowl. If they were not fishing, the crew sorted their catch and fixed their nets, which were prone to ripping. One boy, his shirt smudged with fish guts, proudly showed off his 2 missing fingers, severed by a net that had coiled around a spinning crank. Their hands, which virtually never dried, had open wounds, slit from fish scales and torn from the net's friction. The boys stitched closed the deeper cuts themselves. Infections were constant. Captains never lacked for amphetamines to help the crews work longer, but they rarely stocked antibiotics for infected wounds. On boats like these, deckhands were often beaten for small transgressions, like fixing a torn net too slowly or mistakenly placing a mackerel into a bucket for sablefish or herring. Disobedience on these ships was less a misdemeanor than a capital offense. In 2009, the UN conducted a survey of about 50 Cambodian men and boys sold to Thai fishing boats. Of those interviewed by UN personnel, 29 said they witnessed their captain or other officers kill a worker. The boys and men who typically worked on these ships were invisible to the authorities because most were undocumented immigrants. Dispatched into the unknown, they were beyond where society could help them, usually on so-called ghost ships, unregistered vessels that the Thai government had no ability to track. They usually did not speak the language of their Thai captains, did not know how to swim, and being from inland villages, had never seen the sea before this encounter with it. Virtually all of the crew had a debt to clear, part of their indentured servitude, a travel-now, pay-later labor system that requires working to pay off money they often had to borrow to sneak illegally into a new country. One of the Cambodian boys approached me, and deeper into our conversation, he tried to explain, in broken English, how elusive this debt became once they left land. Pointing to his own shadow and moving around as if he were trying to grab it, he said, "Can't catch." This was a brutal place, one that I spent 5 weeks in the winter of 2014 trying to visit. Fishing boats on the South China Sea, especially in the Thai fleet, had for years been notorious for using so-called sea slaves, mostly migrants forced offshore by debt or duress. The worst among these ships were the long haulers, many of which fished hundreds of miles from shore, staying at sea sometimes for over a year, as mother ships provided supplies and shuttled their catch back to shore. No captain had been willing to carry me and a photographer the full distance, more than 100 miles, out to these long-haul boats. So we instead hopscotched from boat to boat, 40 miles on one, 40 on the next, and so on, to get out far enough. As I watched the Cambodians, who, like some waterbound chain gang, chanted to ensure synchronicity in pulling their nets, I was reminded of an incongruity that confronted me time and again over several years of reporting offshore. For all its breathtaking beauty, the ocean is also a dystopian place, home to dark inhumanities. The rule of law, often so solid on land, bolstered and clarified by centuries of careful wordsmithing, hard-fought jurisdictional lines, and robust enforcement regimes, is fluid at sea, if it's to be found at all. There were other contradictions. At a time when we know exponentially more about the world around us, with so much at our fingertips and but a swipe or a tap away, we know shockingly little about the sea. Fully half of the world's peoples now live within 100 miles of the ocean, and merchant ships haul about 90% of the world's goods. Over 56 million people globally work at sea on fishing boats and another 1.6 million on freighters, tankers, and other types of merchant vessels. And yet, journalism about this realm is a rarity, save for the occasional story about Somali pirates or massive oil spills. For most of us, the sea is simply a place we fly over, a broad canvas of darker and lighter blues. Though it can seem vast and all-powerful, it is vulnerable and fragile, in part because environmental threats travel far, transcending the arbitrary borders that mapmakers have applied to the oceans over the centuries. Like a dissonant chorus in the background, these paradoxes captivated me throughout my journeys, spanning 40 months, 251,000 miles, 85 planes, 40 cities, every continent, over 12,000 nautical miles across all five oceans and 20 other seas. Those travels provided the stories for this book, a compendium of narratives about this unruly frontier. My goal was not only to report on the plight of sea slaves, but also to bring to life the full cast of characters who roam the high seas. They included vigilante conservationists, wreck thieves, maritime mercenaries, defiant whalers, offshore repo men, seabound abortion providers, clandestine oil dumpers, elusive poachers, abandoned seafarers, and cast adrift stowaways. Since I was young, I've been enchanted by the sea, but it was not until one brutally cold Chicago winter that I acted on my fascination. 5 years into a doctoral program in history and anthropology at the University of Chicago, I decided to procrastinate on completing my dissertation by fleeing to Singapore for a temporary job as a deckhand and resident anthropologist on a marine research ship called the RV Heraclitus. For 3 months, the whole time I was there, the ship never left port due to paperwork problems, and I spent the time getting to know the crews from other ships docked nearby. This stranded stint portside in Singapore offered my first real exposure to merchant seafarers and long-haul fishermen, and the experience left me riveted by what seemed like a transient tribe of people. These workers are largely invisible to anyone leading a landlocked lifestyle. They have their own lingo, etiquette, superstitions, social hierarchy, codes of discipline, and, based on the stories they told me, catalog of crimes and tradition of impunity. Theirs is a world where lore holds as much sway as law. What became especially clear in these conversations is that moving freight by sea is much cheaper than by air, partly because international waters are so uncluttered by national bureaucracies and unconstrained by rules. This fact has given rise to all manner of unregulated activity, from tax sheltering to weapons stockpiling. There is, after all, a reason that the American government, for instance, chose international waters as the location for disassembling Syria's chemical weapons arsenal, for conducting some of its terrorism-related detention and interrogation, and for disposing of Osama bin Laden's body. Meanwhile, the fishing and shipping industries are as much victims of offshore lawlessness as they are beneficiaries and perpetrators of it. I never finished my dissertation. Instead, I took a job in 2003 at the New York Times, and over the next decade, as I learned how to be a reporter, I occasionally and unsuccessfully pitched the notion of doing a series about this offshore war.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.